use the latter. Okay, so chapter 28. I am going to be referencing a little bit back on a couple things in back of Genesis, and then I have a couple reference scripture that we're going to get into as well. So as of right now, we've gotten into where Isaac and Esau kind of had a plan where they were going to, you know, Esau was going to get the blessing, and then there was a plan Rebekah and Jacob had that Jacob was going to get the blessing. So like I said, these four, this little family of four, husband, wife, and two sons, they put the funk in dysfunctional. That's what I said last week, because they were all kind of deceiving one another. And one thing that I want to show you is in chapter 28, Jacob is getting ready to get sent away. And Isaac is getting ready to give him the ultimate blessing. It's going to get a lot more detailed in here. And, well, let's just go ahead and start reading. So, verse 1. And Isaac called Jacob and blessed him and charged him and said unto him, thou shalt not take a wife of the daughters of Canaan. So this was fatherly advice. Isaac was telling Jacob the people that he should not marry. He was saying, you know, you can't take the daughters of Canaan. You're going to be a part of the promise. You are going to be where Jesus comes from, you know, our Messiah. So you can't take of those people. God has called Abraham, you know, your grandfather out of that area, and he's called me out of that area, and you can't do that. Arise and go to Paddan Aram. Arise and go to Paddan Aram, to the house of Bethuel, thy mother's father, and take thee a wife from thence of the daughters of Laban, thy mother's brother. Okay, so this was never perceived before. A father has never told a son to go backwards, okay, and take a wife. But the thing is, and what I thought about here is, where did he get this idea to send Jacob back to his wife's family to get a wife? He knew not to take the wife of the Canaanites. That was from God. God said, don't marry those people. But where did he get this advice from? And if you go back to chapters 27 and 24, just one chapter back, where Rebecca is being very dramatic, and Rebecca is the one that was sending Jacob away, and listen to what in verse 43. Now, therefore, my son, obey my voice, and arise, flee thou to Laban, my brother, to Haran. Laban. Thank you, Grandma Mark. Laban. And this was Rebecca telling Jacob, you obey my voice, and you go to my brothers. Okay? And then she says, and tarry with him a few days until thy brother's fury turn away, until thy brother's anger turn away from thee, and he forget that which thou hast done to him. Then I will send and fetch thee from thence. Why should I be deprived also of you both in one day? So she's starting to get a little dramatic. She's starting to face the consequences of her deceit. She's telling her son, you obey what I tell you to do, right? And Rebekah said to Isaac, I am weary of my life because of the daughters of Heath. If Jacob take a wife of the daughters of Heath, such as these which are of the daughters of the land, what good shall my life do me? She's planting a thought into her husband's mind. She's not saying, you send him to my brother's house or else. But she is deceitfully and very discreetly planting a seed, right? Women, we know how to plant a seed in our husbands' minds, right? Yes, we do.
Shows how they bat their eyes.
That's what I was thinking.
That's exactly.
Talk about these devious women.
Yes.
Delilah.
And that's why I think, like, the culture aspect of it, you know, like, I really think that wasn't the case here, because these women really knew how to kind of mislead their men a little bit, okay? I don't want to harp on women too much, but, you know, amen, Barb, you're right, girl, you're right again. We still do know how to bat our eyes and kind of put that seed into our husbands' minds on, well, this is what I think would be best.
He sent a servant back to get Rebecca.
Because God didn't want them back in the land of Canaan, because they got distracted. Egypt was right there. You know, God doesn't sometimes want to send us back. And the first part of this, the lesson that I learned here is we have to be careful whose voice we're listening to. We have to be very, very careful. I heard a lady speak one time at a women's conference, and she said, you know, sometimes I become the voice my husband hears.
Yeah.
Yikes. I mean, and we'll get to the guys too. Don't think I'm just bashing us women, but as wives, you know, and this is what God showed me here, sometimes I've got to be very careful what kind of voice I give my husband, because sometimes I can overshout God. I can overshout God. How's he supposed to hear God when I'm telling him, you obey what I say? Well, I will die if this doesn't happen. How in the world will we get that done? I'm big on that. When, you know, Tim's like, well, you know, I feel like God might want us to wait 2 years. Wait 2 years? 2 years is forever. I will die if we wait 2 years. I mean, I'm putting myself out there. It happens. I do it, you know? And so I kind of overpower God's voice in his head, and I tend to even do it with the boys sometimes. It's okay. I'll take one for the team. But, you know, obey my voice. And I think that was something that, you know, was a bad habit of Rebecca. And I don't know if this was necessarily what God told Isaac to do with Jacob, but I think it's what Rebecca planted. And sometimes we have to lower our voice so that person can hear from God. And I think that's with a lot of things. Advice from friends. A lot of times I will take the advice, and sometimes it's a good advice. I'm not saying that Christian counseling with one another is not but you've got to take God's voice into consideration. That has to be the most important thing. Because a lot of the times, you know, I want to persuade Todd and August to see it the way that me and Tim see it, because then we'll all be together. You know? Like, we can all be, you know, a group of friends together. And sometimes I forget that I might be drowning God's voice out in what they need. Well, have you seeked God in prayer about it first? That really probably needs to be the best advice we give a lot.
That's good, Crystal. It's good.
I wasn't here in the last chapter, when Rebecca sends Jacob away. You know, with all the conniving that Rebecca and Jacob did, once she sent Jacob away and said, you know, once Esau gets over, you know, I will send for you, he never gets to see his mother again.
Nope.
And it makes you wonder if that was kind of a, I hate to say punishment.
I think it was.
You know, that she never got to see him again.
I think there's consequences to all our actions. Yeah. And I think that was the consequence to her action, definitely. Yep, Sharon, I
think. And my thing is, would God do that, not let the mother see the son? And that's kind of hard for me. But that's the only thing I can come up with is, you know, I'll send for you, but yeah, he never did this here again.
No.
He come back when he's dead.
Yeah. But he ended up becoming a servant, you know, in the chapters to come. Jacob faced consequences, you know, doing that with his mother too. But yeah, I think that was her. She thought it would be a couple days, but it was actually she never saw him again. So yeah, there's definitely consequences to her action. And I think, you know, here Isaac was being persuaded, and he wasn't being persuaded. Did it work out? Yes, God used it. You know, God used it. But I just don't think that Isaac was really listening to what God had to say. I think he was listening to the voice of his wife. And guys, don't ignore your wives. I'm not saying that, okay? But because we're really smart and usually right. But I'm just teasing. But the thing is if I love Tim, you know, I need to say, sometimes I need to just not drown God's voice out. And I do that. I find myself that I do that a lot. And I think here that's what Isaac, he was going on the thing that his wife had said. Arise, go to
Padan Aram.
Paddan Aram to the house of Bethuel, my mother's father, and take thee a wife from thence of the daughters of Laban.
Laban.
I'll get it. I will. Thy mother's brother. And God Almighty bless thee and make thee fruitful and multiply thee, that thou mayest be a multitude of people. And give thee the blessing of Abraham. So in the previous chapter, he was kind of giving him a blanket blessing, but this is the blessing, the Abraham blessing, okay? And give thee the blessing of Abraham to thee and to thy seed with thee, that thou mayest inherit the land wherein thou art a stranger, which God gave unto Abraham. And Isaac sent away Jacob, and he went to Paddan Aram unto Laban.
Laban.
Son of Bethel. I'm so glad God loves me. Laban, son of Bethel, the Syrian, the brother of Rebekah, Jacob's, and Esau's mother. When Esau saw that Isaac had blessed Jacob. We got to remember, people were watching what happens. Esau was watching this take place, and he felt frustrated. Okay? This was all supposed to be, in his mind, his blessing. And he saw what was happening. When Esau saw that Isaac had blessed Jacob and sent him away to Paddan Aram, to take him a wife from thence, and that as he blessed him, he gave him a charge, saying, thou shalt not take a wife of the daughters of Canaan. So where was this whole information and instruction when Esau was picking wives? I mean, don't you think, like, I kind of think, like, when I was reading this, I thought, okay, Esau's watching this exchange happen between father and son, and he's saying, why did he never tell me not? Because remember, Esau had already married two Canaanite Hittite women. And these twins are 77 years old at this time. So there's a pretty big gap of instruction that should have taken place here. And I'm sure Esau's thinking, well, why did he never tell me not to take wives of the Canaanite women? You know, where was my instruction? So, men, here we go. You have a serious duty here to your children to instruct them the ways of the Lord.
Yeah.
Absolutely, yes. Women, they are the head. You are the neck, okay? They are the head of the household. And men, you have an ultimate duty to instruct your sons and daughters on what God expects. How he expects you to run your family, how he expects you to treat your wife, how he expects you to raise your kids and instruct your children. And I think here, maybe Isaac fell short on this. Like, where was this conversation when the kids were, like, in their 40s? Why was this conversation going on right now? And that Jacob obeyed his father and his mother and was gone to Paddan Aram. I should have practiced these words. So Esau was watching this exchange happen between father and son, and he was watching Jacob be obedient to his father. And it frustrated him. I think that there was a farewell that was happening with Jacob, but I think there was a frustration that was happening with Esau. And we got to remember, some of us are in different battles. Some of us are saying goodbye to things, and God is calling us out onto things. And other people are watching, and they're frustrated because they're thinking, where's my farewell? Where's my blessing? So we've got to be, again, very careful on whose voice we're listening to, whose advice we're getting from. Are we given the instruction that we need to be giving? And Esau, seeing that the daughters of Canaan pleased not Isaac his father, then went Esau unto Ishmael and took unto the wives which he had Mahath, the daughter of Ishmael, Abraham's son, the sister of Naboth, to be his wife. This is huge here. Esau had a frustration. He saw what finally pleased his father. It was to marry the right person, to marry into Abraham's promised family. But he went about it the entirely wrong way. And I think, okay, Esau is trying to get in by works. That's what he's doing here. And let me show you something, because I think Esau always grew up being loved by what he did, by what he had to offer. Back in Genesis 20, no, let me think here for just a minute. I had a mark too. Genesis 25, 28. And Isaac loved Esau because he did eat of his venison. But Rebekah loved Jacob. There's no because. There's no why Rebekah loved Jacob. She just loved him. She loved Jacob because Jacob was Jacob.
She loved him because the Lord said that he was going to be her son.
Right, but there was nothing that Jacob could have done that would have caused her love to be any greater or any less. Here, I think Isaac loved Esau because he did eat. Isaac, yes, she loved him because that was the one, but I think she loved Esau too. But I think that she loved Jacob because she knew that's where the promise would come through. But Isaac chose which one he loved the most because of the works that were done. Isaac loved Esau because of who Esau was. He didn't love him because that was my son, and even though he's not the chosen one, I love him. He loved him because of what he done, because he was the firstborn. You know, and that's kind of how religion is, or if you think about it, a lot of the times I look at my father's love because of what I do. I feel like that's how he's going to love me, and that's how I'm going to get the blessing. I'm going to get the blessing because I bring the venison. I'm going to get the blessing because I teach Bible school. I'm going to get the blessing because I'm here on Wednesday nights, Sunday mornings, and Sunday nights. I'm going to get the blessing because. And you got to see that was the relationship between Esau and his father. And we've got to be careful that that's not the relationship between us and our father. That it's not because he loves me because. The relationship that we should have is, but Rebekah loved Jacob. But God loved Donnie. Not because. Not because of. Great. You're not loved and blessed and forgiven and shown mercy and have access to Jesus Christ because of. You're just loved. And you know, that's what I think Esau was trying to do here. He saw what pleased his father, so he took it upon himself to devise a plan to go and try to marry into Abraham's family. See, he was trying to do something that would please his father. That's why he went about it the wrong way, and those were separate from Abraham's blessings. Ishmael was, but, you know, that was him trying to form. He felt a frustration, right? He felt a frustration that he was separate from the blessing. So he tried to go get works. He tried to go get it by works.
Yeah.
That's what I'm trying to say there.
But Esau already had gone off and ready to fight him.
Right.
Yeah. And without evidently asking his dad.
Right.
Yeah.
And you know, this is the thing. He was already not chosen before he did anything. Jacob was chosen in the womb. So when it comes to God, there's not a villain and a hero. Because Jacob was chosen before works even came into play, you know? And in Esau kept trying to do things to acquire that love of his father. And yeah, I want to think of Esau as a villain, but the thing is Jacob was chosen, and Esau kept trying to get that worth of his father by works, you know? Well, I'm the first, so it's automatically I should be the one. Well, I'll just go marry into Abraham's family, and then I'll get some of the blessing. So I think that we need to remember that. And I honestly kind of feel sorry for Esau. I'm mean, I do. I kind of feel like the father should have instructed. Maybe if they all sat down together and they were instructed and they grew up with that love, you know, and were explained that a little bit better. Because, I mean, this instruction not to marry women, a wife of the daughter of Canaan's, was given after the blessing had already been taken.
I wanted to mention something last week and totally forgot about it, but it, you know, the firstborn also, when the dad passes away, he also takes the responsibility of actually caring for the family. So that's something too, that when he gave up those birthrights that he gave up too. So, you know, when you look at that, you know, just like Sawyer is responsible for taking care of me and Sierra, you know, and if he would give that to Solomon, that would be taken away from him too, you know. And I just thought that was, you know, not only did he lose the birthright of the blessing, he also lost the responsibility.
Right.
You know, and I just, even talking about this, there's a lot of responsibility there to gain and blessings to gain with that, and he doesn't have that.
Right. And I've got here, Esau went to Ishmael to marry the daughters, and these daughters, if you think of the land that he went to Shur and Assyria. These are the enemies of God's people, is where he went. And I put, fleshly striving is your blessing dying.
Yeah.
When I'm fleshly striving to get my Father's love, my blessings are dying daily. There's nothing in and of my flesh. There's nothing that I can do. I can't marry into it. I can't, you know, hunt my way through it. Fleshly striving is my blessings dying. I'm never going to get the blessings of God by doing it in and of myself.
Yeah.
And I think that was the mindset that Esau had. I think he thought, I'm firstborn, I have it in the back. This is an easy blessing. You know, and I think that's the one thing that we can learn from him. We can learn from Isaac and Rebecca how we need to instruct our children and how wives can be, you know, let our husbands lead. And then from Esau, though, I think that in that frustration, we have to stop trying to allow our flesh to be what gives us our worth in Christ. That's not it.
Families are still like that, though. Two boys, if the one boy's like Esau and goes out and hunts with his dad and runs all over the field, they do all this building and everything, and the other boy stays home with his wife cooking.
Right.
Okay. It's always that problem.
Right.
Now, I wonder if Esau just didn't, because he was upset with Isaac, because the blessing was not with Jacob. If he may not have done it out of spite.
I thought that. I really did think that at first, that he went, fine, I'll just go over to Ishmael and get some of his daughters. But I think he was trying to please his, me personally. Now, I could be wrong. But me, the way that God explained it to my heart, I think he was trying to please his father. I think he was trying to get in, because it says, and Esau seeing that the daughters of Canaan pleased not Isaac his father, and then went Esau unto Ishmael and took unto the wives which he had. Like, I think he thought that he was going to get into Abraham's bloodline somehow. Because Ishmael was actually...
If he was trying to please Isaac, he would have thought he would have said something to him about before he even married him.
Yeah.
Well, the whole point is, he didn't know until then.
Yeah.
That when he talked to,
I don't think he knew that it displeased him.
He wanted to go get over there to get his wife. He didn't know that he wasn't supposed to do it.
Yeah, I don't think he knew. I don't think he knew. I think he was seeing it for the first time. Like, oh, that's what pleases him. Like, I want to get in good graces with my father. And a lot as
a thing, though, that because they, well, you know, they were enemies. I mean, not enemies, but they were not good people.
Yeah, but I think that Ishmael still had a relationship with Isaac because they were there when Abraham passed away. Like, I think, I mean, I don't know. I think that maybe they were still communicating, but I think everybody knew that that's not where Abraham's blessing was, that it didn't lie in Ishmael. But I think Esau was trying to skirt around it somehow to get into the blessing. And I mean, even me as a Christian, you know, that's what you gotta kinda, sometimes you gotta reel back and okay, what's God trying to show me in this? You know, like, I think he's trying to show me that if you're fleshly striving to try to get the the blessing. It's not coming that way. It's got to be a calling from God. It's got to be what God called it, you know. And with Rebecca, don't listen to anybody's voice but God's voice. God, you know, and that's what she, her and Isaac had a tendency, I think, problems were doing, is they, Isaac was seeing it, you know, his way. This is how it's always been. The firstborn gets the blessing. On what Rebecca said, God told her, this is how we're going to do it, my way or the highway. And I think Rebecca was kind of being deceitful, you know, as far as you listen to my voice, you know.
Do you think Esau knew any of this before Jacob got Abraham and Isaac's blessing? Do you think since Jacob was always the chosen
one,
that he, there was ever any talk of it, or he knew that that was going to happen?
You would think there would be any talk.
I don't think that they shared it with him. I honestly, like, the way that it just seems to me and how surprised the boys are, I don't know. I mean, you can chime in here if whatever opinion. I guess that would be a matter of opinion. I don't think they knew. And I think that that was one of the downfalls of the family, is that, you know, they didn't share with each other what God had told them, you know, that counsel. And not once does any of them say, what does God have to say about this?
Well, you know, women didn't have a very big word in anything. And I expect that Rebecca told Isaac that the Lord told her that the second baby was going to be, he probably thought, well, maybe you don't know anything about it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a man, I know the Lord, I know what's going on. And I think she probably said something about that in her time with that man.
Mm-hmm.
I know one thing is, since Esau, you know, was a hunter, and that means, you know, being nomadic and things like that, if he wasn't just off on, you know, doing that and came home in this with these women and they're like, no.
Yeah.
Maybe we should have said something.
We should have instructed the boys a little bit better.
Yeah.
But he looked at it all wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Because Esau was supposed to be the servant of Jacob, that could have been a good thing.
Yeah.
I mean, you could have still been part of the blessing,
yeah,
in helping Jacob, but everybody's got to be number one or the
right,
best or all that. And that, I mean, that just like in our churches today, everybody wants to be
everything.
That one, and that's the reason there's so many trouble. I mean,
I fully believe that. I believe if they would have raised those boys in the pride that Jacob, you know, God had a calling on Jacob and Esau, you're going to help him. I don't think, I'm a servant to God. I don't see that as a bad thing. Now, if you would have said that to me, you know, and I hear people say, well, how am I? Oh, yeah, this almighty God that I'm supposed to serve, you know. No, you're getting it all wrong. And I, you know, because they have never been explained that servanthood is a good thing. Like, and I think if the boys would have been instructed that way and been explained, but see, Rebecca and Isaac were kind of being deceitful with even one another. Now, I personally think that the women here, Sarah and Rebecca, I think they had a little bit more of a voice than we're giving them credit for. I mean, I think we're thinking of this nationality and this culture the way it is today, which is not the way God intended it to ever be. A husband and wife are supposed to be one. Okay? So when we think, well, women in that time don't show their faces and don't talk, that's how it is today. That's not God's way. And I think these women, husbands and wives, I don't know, I think they shared some. Sarah was like, you do this or else. You sleep with her, or you give me a kid, you give me a kid this way. I don't think she was a shy woman on how she was expressing what she wanted done. And I think Rebecca was a little conniving or cunning in a way where she was just planting the seeds. So I don't want to throw everything over onto the man here, you know, well, he bossed him around. I think the women had a little bit of a voice. I think they shook their bunny little fingers.
But that happened in today's society. When you look at a husband and wife, if they're not on the same page, if your goal is here and your husband's goal is here and you've got kids in that mix, your kids are torn because they're not receiving instruction of, you know, one person, which the husband and wife should be. You should be able to, like mine, you should be guiding your children in the same direction. So you have a tendency, this one's whispering in this one's ear, this one's whispering in this one's ear. So there's always, you're placing that division amongst your children from birth, whether you know it or not.
Yeah.
So if there's one of, if your kids grow up with that animosity, it just creates further division in the family to the point where the one is never going to serve the other willingly.
Right.
Regardless of birthright or age. I mean, I fully believe that had Esau gotten a blessing, Jacob would have probably been disgruntled about serving Esau as well because of the division, the favoritism that his father showed Esau versus Rebecca showed him. So I don't, regardless of who ended up getting the blessing, I think that seed was planted already because of the differences between Isaac and Rebecca.
But then you think about Abraham, how many wives did he have?
Yeah. It's hard to be a good wife when you got your husband.
Well, he had more than one wife. He had
other
women. Yeah. So, yeah, no, it would be hard, I would think, to.
But Sarah was where the promise was supposed to come through. Yeah.
Yeah, I understand that.
Yeah.
But
I think the big takeaway home here is first, how is he supposed to hear from God and God's voice? I'm always chiming. If I'm overpowering God's voice, and how are my children supposed to learn to listen to what God wants in their life? Don't get me wrong. I think as parents should be explaining and instructing. That's why we bring them to church. They're not just supposed to hear what I think, but they're supposed to hear the word of God and how it's explained and share with the other kids that are out there. You know, those things are important because that's them learning to listen to God's voice without mom and dad chattering in the background. And if dad's saying one thing and mom's saying another thing and God's down the middle saying another thing, well, they don't know what in the world to listen to. I'm going to marry this lady and I'm going to marry this lady here and I hate my brother and mom doesn't know what she's talking about and I like dad. And, you know, and then you see that. Like, I see that in, you know, kids today that go to school with, that are friends with the boys. Like, you know, you see this, no wonder the enemy wants to separate the family. No wonder the enemy wants his marriages to be broken. Because he wants kids to be confused. He wants kids to be like, well, dad says this, mom says this, I hate her, he hates, you know, me. Like, so, of course, that's the thing that you want to, you know, the foundation that you want to break. Because then the next generation coming up doesn't know what to think. And you can see that in today's world, that they really don't, I mean, and Joey's right. A lot of them don't realize. They don't know what to think. Some of the things that Mason's friends tell him, where do they even get that information? He's like, oh, their mom told him, and he hates his mom, but you know, his dad said that it's okay for him to hate his mom. I mean, they don't know. And I think that was what was happening to Esau and Jacob here. I don't think they knew whose voice to listen to. And that's, you know, that's a big takeaway home there. You got to listen to God's voice. I mean, my friends and my mom and my husband, they all, I know, have the best interest at heart, but God is the ultimate person that needs to direct my path. Have you ever had not known that something was bad or not known that something was good until someone's like, you shouldn't be doing that. That's not the way. You're going to get God that way. What? Why didn't God tell me that? Why didn't God reveal that to me? You know what I mean? So sometimes we got to be very careful whose voice we're listening to.
I think that's the problem. They weren't willing to serve any of them,
right?
They all wanted help,
right?
Because even way back when he was the man, Abraham, when they went into that one city, he said, "This is not my wife. This is my sister."
Yeah.
You know, and they were trying to figure it out on their own instead of just going in and saying, you know, this is my wife. And,
protect me.
Yeah. You know, and trust in God. And then I said, that's the kind of storm compounds itself.
Yeah.
If they had all just been good servants.
Right. That's a good point.
It'd be a short book, but.
Yeah.
But it worked out a lot better for them.
But a lot of times I don't want to be in the servant role. Right. Or I don't want to be the lowest person on the servant totem pole. You know? I don't want to be the one that's greeting in the back door. I want to be the one up here doing Bible study. I don't want to be the one back there. you know, I want to be up there with the youth going roller skating or to concerts. I don't, you know, I don't want to do that over there. So that, yeah, I think that a lot of times people have, I don't want to be last, I want to be first. That was a big conversation here. I don't want to be where God tells me to be. I want to be up in a high place. So, yeah, that's definitely a good point. So the next couple chapters is where Jacob has his conversion with God, okay? And back in Genesis 27:20, when Jacob's in the thick of his lies to Isaac, okay, he's acting like brother Esau, right? He's bringing him the goat. I think he brought him goat instead of venison. And listen to how he refers to God. In chapter 27, verse 20, and Isaac said unto his son, how is it that thou hast found it so quickly, my son? And he said, because the Lord thy God brought it to me. Not my God, thy God. Okay, so he's saying there, because your God brought it to me. So I think that up till this point, Jacob maybe had a superficial relationship with God, but I don't think that he had a personal relationship with God up until this moment. I think this right here, God appears to Jacob, and this is where a conversion happens. It's powerful, okay? And I think I lived that life for a long time where I knew who God was. God had been mentioned several times throughout my whole childhood. I knew that there was a blessing there, but I didn't have that personal relationship with God, okay? So that's where we're going to start. And why I use the word, I put when conversion comes. And conversion means a change and a transformation. So when conversion comes, and that's what's getting ready to happen here. And I want you to remember, Jacob's just got the big blessing, okay? He just got the Cadillac and the job at DuPont. I mean, I am in God's graces. I am going to walk tall. I am going to multiply. The Messiah is going to come through my bloodline. And I don't know if he really walked away knowing the seriousness of the blessing. And I want you to think about that. Do you walk around realizing the seriousness of the blessing? The cost. You were called. You were appointed. But do you really realize the seriousness of it? Sometimes I don't think I reverence God enough. Like, I don't realize the seriousness of my calling. And that's why God came to him here. And Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. And he lighted upon a certain place and tarried there all night, because the sun was set, and he took of the stones of that place and put them for his pillows and lay down in that place to sleep. So night has come up on him, okay? And he's called out. He's called out of his comfort zone. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God as ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, thy father, and the God of Isaac. The land whereon thou liest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed. And thy seed shall be as dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south. And in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. And behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest, and will bring thee again into this land, for I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee. Okay, I wanted to read all that because I wanted you to get this. This was a vision. He came into the presence of God for the first time in his life. Okay? And the thing I've got right out here is, ultimately, to be in the will of God, you have to get out of the way of God.
Yeah.
To be in the will of God, you have to get out of the way of God. This wasn't Jacob scheming. This wasn't Jacob and his, this wasn't Bond's voice. This was God. He had come into the presence and the power of God for the first time. And I got here, you know, to be in the will of God, you have to get out of the way of God. And sometimes that's when God shows up, is when we, that's not sometimes. God shows up when we get out of the way. He was in the dark. He was in a place he was unfamiliar with. He had rocks as a pillow. I don't think that that's very comfortable, do you? And God showed up. And the thing here is that I loved and why I brought the ladder. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven, and behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. And then after he gives him that vision, he starts giving him the promise. He starts telling him, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. This will be your land. I will protect you. I will always. This is a personal conversation. John chapter 1, verse 51. This was Jesus talking, okay? And Nathanael, Philip had went to Nathanael and said, hey, I've met the Messiah. And Nathanael said, what? I'm just paraphrasing here, but what any good things come out of Nazareth? I mean,
yeah.
Nothing's good come out of there. Mm-hmm. And Jesus tells him, I've seen you. I see you. I've seen you underneath the tree. And when he says that, Nathanael believes. Oh, since you've seen me, I know you're the Messiah. And Jesus says, no, you haven't seen nothing yet. You haven't seen nothing yet. Listen, chapter 1, verse 51. And he saith unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, these are written in red, hereafter ye shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending up on the Son of Man. Angels of God is you. Over here, Jacob saw the ladder as God. That's how he went from heaven to earth. Okay, that's how he experienced heavenly things. Right? He saw a connection from where he was to heavenly realms by this ladder. Correct? Are we all right on that, on that vision? Jesus over here refers to himself as the ladder. You see, before the covenant, Abraham's covenant, was that ladder and that access from Jacob to God. Jacob, I'm going to give you blessings. I'm going to protect you. It was the only way. He had to be asleep. He had to hear right from God. And he had to see the blessings coming from heaven to earth. How we can reach heavenly places. Now, Jesus is our ladder. I don't have to depend on a vision at night in a dark place with rocks as my pillows. I can sit in a padded pew in an air-conditioned church with fans going and me sipping water out of my straw, and I can use Jesus as my ladder, and I can go up to God, and I can extend his blessings can come down to me, and I can go into heavenly places because I'm climbing and I'm stepping on Jesus to get there. This is huge. See, sometimes I'm like, God, hey God, your ways are higher than my ways, and I know you don't want me to know them. But if you could you? Would you? But see, now I don't have to do that. I can go into the heavenly places anytime I want. I don't have to have a Abraham's covenant. I don't have to depend on being the chosen one, right? Who, if Rebecca thinks I'm worthy, or if Isaac thinks I'm worthy, or if I go get a good deer and feed my dad, or if I'm a good person, or if I taught a good lesson, or if I came to church enough, or if there's only two people in the house tonight. Look, it only takes me and Jesus. And I can go from heaven to earth father's Jesus. Okay?
Amen.
That's why I love you guys, and I don't want you guys to climb on the ladder too, but I don't need you to access heaven. I'm just being serious, okay? Like, it was Jacob by himself with a rock as a pillow. And he saw the angels of God descending and ascending. And it's such an important vision, and it's something that we need to wrap our minds around, because Jesus mentioned it again in red. I'm the ladder that you ascend and descend on. I'm the one that gets you into the heavenly places. And the things from heaven come down to earth through me. You haven't seen nothing yet. That's what Jesus was saying. You haven't seen nothing yet. Because I'm the one that gets you there. See, a lot of times, and I love this thing. Me and Tim bought me this a year ago.
Probably.
I use it all the time. If any of y'all get married, I'm buying you one of these for your wedding shower. I use it all the time. And I know I was thinking, well, I just get a stool and step on it. I know. It's just, and a lot of people do. A lot of people use other things to get to heavenly places, but they're not nothing like the ladder. This is a sure thing. You ain't gonna fall. But this is what Jacob. God was that ladder for him. That covenant and that blessing, that was the ladder in his vision.
Yeah.
Your ladder is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Without him, we cannot get to heaven.
Can't. And you know, today, in the minds, people are saying, listen to my voice. You want to get the blessing? You listen to my voice. I'll tell you how to get to the heavenly places. This is what you got to do. Because of. That's how Esau got his love. Because of. Isaac loved Esau because of what he did. Not how it works. Jesus is my access to God. And I can take him anywhere I want to go. It doesn't matter who's in the house. As long as Jesus is in the house.
Amen.
Okay? So that was huge for me. Now every time I see a ladder, I'm going to think of Jesus. But that John chapter 151, when God revealed that to me, Jesus saying, can you put that back up there?
There
he is. And he saith unto him, and this is him talking to Nathanael, because Nathanael saw him saw Jesus do a big thing. He told him where he was. He's like, yeah, I seen you. I seen you down there in the shade, underneath the shade, relaxing. And he's like, oh, you have to be the Messiah. You haven't seen nothing yet. That's what Jesus was saying here. And he saith unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter ye shall see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending up on the Son of Man. You want to descend and ascend from heaven to earth? Get up on the Son of Man and start climbing. And that's what, you can have that conversion. That's how we get transformed. This was a transformation. Jacob was experiencing God for the first time. And behold, so he goes on and he gives him the promise. And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. And behold, I am with thee and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest, and will bring thee again into this land, for I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee of. So, and when he experienced, and I don't want to stunt your growth or tell you that you need to sit down and be quiet to experience God, but this was in a time of rest when Jacob experienced. And that's what I'm saying. If you want to get into God's will, sometimes you have to get out of God's way to do it. And that's what Jacob was doing here. He didn't go any further. Darkness fell. He laid down, and God came to him. And when he talks here, he talks about that promise. I will bring thee again into this land. So you think about when Moses was writing this, what the people were thinking. They had been driven out of that land, right? the promised land. I mean, they were looking at this. This was their promise. They were looking across the, I imagine them looking across the Jordan and thinking, that's our land. God told Jacob that he would bring us back to that land. So, you know, my kids, they grab a hold of my promise, too. You know, they see God promised my mom that he would never leave her or forsake her. And you know, God's people were holding on to this promise. And Jacob awaked out of his sleep, and he said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not. And he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. And Jacob rose up early in the morning and took the stone that he had put for his pillows and set it up for a pillar and poured oil up on the top of it. So it became a place of worship. He pulled it, you know, that thing that was causing him discomfort, I'm sure, of his sleep on, he caused it to be a monument, a memorial for where God had been, where he had experienced God. And he called the name of that place Bethel. Bethel, the definition of Bethel, is a holy place. But the name of that city was called Luz at the first. And Jacob vowed a vow, saying, if God will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go, and will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on, so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God. See, the chapter before that, he said, thy God. Your God does it. Now, he experienced the latter, right? So it's his God. He's calling him, my God. And this stone which I have set for a pillar shall be God's house, and all that thou shalt give me, I will surely give the tenth unto thee. That was the tithe. So, I mean, he experienced God in a big way here. And this is what I want you to remember. You have access to the ladder, to the heavenly places at all times through Jesus. Through Jesus Christ, you don't have to fall asleep and have a vision of God coming down and showing you something. You have access to that heavenly place at all times. This is your Abraham blessing. You don't have to be chosen, decide, am I chosen, am I not chosen? Is this a mistake, is this not a mistake? You are worthy. Through Jesus, you have the blessings of Abraham.
Amen.
We'll go into chapter 29.
Bless Christmas.